I think the internet got to a place where we confused open with free. What we can build together is much bigger than what any of us could build alone.
So, what is the one thing that defines you best?
Collaboration, the systems and thinking, and how do you align everyone's incentives and those sorts of things.
Was an event in your life where it showed you that this is actually the way you want to shape things?
So when I was in college, I started a email mailing list. This I'm talking 1992, called the SF Raves mailing list for the San Francisco rave community. And we would share information about parties that were happening, the good ones, the ones you want to stay away from. And we found that the people on the list said, well, if we know how to do a good party, why don't we put on our own? So we started to throw events on beaches and in parks, you know, and it was a very collaborative kind of thing. And then around the same time, learning about how the internet was built kind of the same way. People said, we've got these machines, how do we connect them? Let's work out protocols and ways of connecting that don't require us to have somebody playing God at the center. Or don't require us having to pay all one person, right? It was a very cooperative kind of thing. And so open source software, I started working on Apache and that sort of thing, but it really came from that sense of, well, what we can build together is much bigger than what any of us could build alone.
And so what is the power of open source and why is it so interesting?
Well, I mean, it's incredibly empowering to give you software that lets you go and do things rather than giving you a free service, you know, like Gmail. Right. If you use Gmail, if I'm the Gmail server and you're a Gmail user, you're always coming to me and having like every 5 minutes checking your mail. If I go down, you're out of luck. If I give you an email server for you to run on a computer at home, right, you don't have to worry about me. I can disappear. I can die. I can go off and do something different. And that's empowering. Right. But I think the internet got to a place where we confused open with free, you know, being able to use open source software like Apache or PostFix, like a free mail server, with the free email you get at Gmail, right? And I'd love us to get back more to that former kind of like sense of what open source was. And that's in part what we're doing at the Linux Foundation and at Hyperledger. And it turns out that's also good for business. Because if you're a business and you're dependent upon me, now your business will fail if I fail. But if I've given you software, your business is now independent and has more power and can grow, right? So it turns out businesses realize this more and more. They don't want to get trapped. And so open source software is about avoiding that trap.
Open source doesn't necessarily go with profit. How does it actually fit in the current capitalistic system?
Yeah, open source software isn't a business model by itself. And you're not going to get rich by writing software and giving it away for free, I promise, right? Every company has to build software. I don't care what you do. You know, you can be the most boring software company in the world and you still have to write software. Some of that software is about simply being able to put up a website, being able to like exist in this world. Sometimes the term is called table stakes. It's boring, it's non-differentiating, it's what you need to do to be in the same business as your competitors. And then there's stuff that is unique value proposition, stuff that is differentiating, stuff that creates like that distinct edge for you compared to other people. So the former stuff you should collaborate on, you should use any existing open source software. And if you fix bugs, add features to it, like create a virtuous cycle there, that's a good thing. But companies should also feel free to build that competitive differentiation and do that as a proprietary code, do that as something you don't yet give away. And so that line between the two is really important to figure out and to get right. And also that line over time creeps uphill because in 1 year, what you think is differentiated and unique, the next year, everyone else is doing. So you want to give that away so you can move up the stack to the next thing.
How can we outcompete destructive systems?
Okay, so one of my mentors is a guy named Tim O'Reilly, and one of his recurring kind of like concepts was create more value than you capture. You'll end up ahead, as will everyone else. And you know what? That's actually not that much different than the philosophy put together by Klaus Schwab, the guy who started the World Economic Forum. In 1971, when he started the forum, he had just received an economics PhD in stakeholder theory, which said if you're in the business and you have a business decision to make, you shouldn't make that decision based only on shareholder interest. You should make that decision based on stakeholder interest. And that if you do that, like go and talk to everybody who will be affected by that decision, right? Yeah. And take a big picture view of it. And if you do that, likely the optimal outcome will be arrived at. Not only will your shareholders be happy, but the people who you affect will probably be happy too. I think as if you're not like a CEO, who you decide to work for on a day-to-day basis matters. Whose products you decide to buy matters. Decisions to buy organic food versus not organic food matter. That's how we shift capitalism towards better outcomes.